Now, in order to really understand this doctrine of Balaam and why I'm saying it's equal to the doctrine of Zionism, I'm going to continue looking in Numbers 22 to 24 to some certain parts that I highlighted that will give us more understanding. Now, I showed already with my table that everything that Balaam said is what we are told today in Christian Zionism. We are told he who blesses Israel will be blessed and he who curses Israel will be cursed. And that came out very strongly in this doctrine of Balaam. And then also it was about the Messiah. It's a messianic prophecy and it's well known to be that way. So my question is why? Is an obvious hireling and a false prophet giving a true prophecy? And how does this prophecy actually work to bring destruction, not only to Israel, which we saw when we read on in Numbers 25, where a plague came upon the people and they started to fornicate with the Moabites and also to commit idolatry? Which is exactly what we read in Revelation regarding Jezebel, and regarding Balaam, which we read that teach the people to fornicate and eat things sacrificed to idols. Now, if we read those chapters about Balaam, we know he kept saying he was just going to say what God told him to say and nothing else. In other words, he was taking the scriptures and saying what he saw written in his different visions and the oracles he gave. And this is the problem, people, that we need to face and look. The first thing I want to show you is this scripture here, Hebrews 4, verse 12, which says, "For the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart." So the first thing is we need to understand that the scriptures, the word of God, is a two-edged sword. It's a weapon and it works both ways. It's dangerous. It's a dangerous weapon if you don't know how to use it. And it's also a dangerous weapon if you do know how to use it in a deceptive way. And it is a good weapon, an offensive and a defensive weapon, if you are listening to the voice of the true shepherd, Jesus Christ, and you use the sword to make lawful spiritual war. So there are three ways in which this sword is dangerous. A lawful good way, which is the word of God coming out of the mouth of the Messiah or of a believer who speaks the words, as the Lord said, rivers of living water will come out of the belly to bring healing to the nations. Or it can be in the mouth of Satan, as we read in Matthew 4, where Satan comes and quotes scripture at Christ. And those scriptures are, if heeded, would lead to destruction, which is exactly what we deal with here with a false prophet. They use the word of God also as a sword. And so this is Satan's sword. And that is what people do not understand. They see it only as a good thing and do not realize how it's used of the enemy against us. We need to also not just think of Satan in the spiritual form, but as manifested in flesh and blood, enemies of God's people who speak the word in the form of false prophecies, who are false prophets, false teachers in the churches, using the sword to kill us spiritually. And then the third way of using the sword dangerously is if we don't know what we're doing, if we are unlearned in the things of God, if God hasn't taught you and you have learned from wicked men or from deceived men, you can cut yourself with a sword. So this is something we need to face. And people do not face it. They want to believe that everybody that says, Lord, Lord, is good and clean and on their side. And so that is the, I think for me, the key to understanding Balaam. I've really been thinking a lot about how this Zionist doctrine is obviously destructive, how the words of Balaam match exactly, and why would the prophecy of the Messiah lead to our destruction? We see in this story the destruction of the Israelites, despite the fact that Balaam couldn't curse them. This prophecy also led to the destruction of the Moabites in this plague, which obviously affected them too when they fornicated with the Israelites. Balaam himself later was killed by the sword. We read that also later on in the Bible. So this messianic prophecy led to utter destruction, and you can see this messianic prophecy is all about destruction. So how do we understand that? How do we understand Jesus Christ being a healer of the nations, yet being preached as a destroyer of the nations, when he himself, when James and John wanted to call down fire from heaven, he rebuked them and said, the Son of Man came to save men's lives. And when the true Messiah, which we know his voice of, is one of mercy, yes, he rebukes sins and he helps us to correct ourselves, but he is not the way we know him, this destroyer, yet he is preached as both, as this merciful lamb, yet this wrathful lion. So we need to understand that, because this doctrine is destroying the Christian church. It is destroying the Western world. It is causing the destruction, for example, of the Palestinians who are being slaughtered in front of everybody, with people cheering it on and others unable to do anything about it. And it's going to cause even worse destruction if we don't start to understand what is being done against us. So if you haven't yet read Numbers 22 to 24, it's important that you need to read that. Otherwise, you won't really understand what I'm saying if you don't know the chapters. However, now we did read it. Now we are going to actually look at some of the highlighted points that are going to show you what I'm thinking, is that what Balaam did was he prophesied prophecies which all seem to point to one Messiah, yet they are mixing up the prophecy of the Messiah as we know him in Christianity, the merciful Messiah, the Savior of the world, and mixing it up with this Davidic conquering Messiah, which they call this lion from the tribe of Judah, which destroys everything. So these are the two different messiahs. The one of Christianity is vastly different. The teaching of Christianity, as I received it, is that Jesus Christ came and he, through speaking the word of God, he came as the Messiah. He spoke the true words of God, because the basically the Old Testament scriptures have corruption in them. It speaks about the lying pen of the scribe, and that they had added traditions and things which God did not want. And it's very difficult today to know exactly what has been done. So people generally see the Bible as this inerrant word of God with everything that is true. But if you look at the world today, you will know that the churches and the systems, the political systems, all are extremely corrupt. They cannot be trusted. Jesus himself basically was saying that they'd corrupted themselves and the scriptures. And so it is only by hearing the voice of the shepherd and receiving the spirit of the truth that you can actually perceive the true Messiah and the Father, the Heavenly Father, who does not work the way they say he does by being this destructive, vengeful God. It's all very deep things, and people get upset at each other about these doctrines, and then we just destroy each other further. So I really want to invite you to listen to those that maybe think slightly differently than you. See things from a other side. We are not going to go to hell because we don't understand things. Most of this extreme reaction against each other, whereby we cut each other up with the sword of God when somebody says something that differs from you. We've learned this behavior by the church, who basically react this way because they cover things up. So they've got their doctrines, and anything that deviates from the doctrine is destroyed. And this is because they serve the system. So whatever they decide is kosher to say or politically correct that you can say, that is called the orthodoxy of the day, and it changes like a chameleon or like a snake that sheds its skin. And anything that's not orthodox is called heretic. So a heretic is not a terrible person, but a heretic is somebody that does not agree with orthodoxy or with what everybody says. My experience in my 57 years of life is that the crowd is usually following evil. And so you cannot trust what everybody says. And that is often how they also frame it, is how can you say something different from the church fathers and from learned doctors of theology? I say that Jesus Christ said exactly that. He said it is a narrow way and that most people are deceived. And so I really invite you not to chop me up with a sword of the spirit because I say things that shock you or offend you. I may not be right about everything I say because I'm a disciple. I'm learning. But I cannot destroy the faith that is in you, because the Holy Spirit in you will enable you to receive truth as you hear it. If you hear something erroneous, you will reject it. Or if I speak truth but you are not yet able to receive it, don't shut me up. Just don't receive it, because you will mature and be able to receive it later on. Likewise, my errors, by examining the scriptures, will fall away from me. And so I welcome correction if it is done in the right spirit. So let us try and help each other and see what the problem is, because when we can see the problem, then we can actually do something about it. At the moment, our eyes have been blinded. Some of us see quite a lot, but we cannot do anything because the masses of the people don't see. But, you know, like Paul said, the body has different parts, and so it's only the eyes that have to see, and it's actually only certain parts of the eye that has to see. So if maybe you're a part of the eye that must see, don't be so despondent about the masses who don't see. Maybe we, the eyes, must see better, have our blind eyes healed, and when we see, the whole body will have light. So it's not necessary that every Christian sees the truth. Only those parts of us that are the eyes must be healed and see the truth, and then the whole body will have light again. So let us work together and help each other and make connections instead of allowing the enemy to divide us and remain in darkness, and that darkness totally overtake and cause our destruction. Now let's look here at some of the scriptures and discuss them. I'm going to be thorough, as I said, in this study, because this study about Balaam is very, very, very important for what is going on in the world at the moment. And often before we can say something in a short, summarized, very potent way in order to open somebody's eyes, we first need to go through the long process of basically crushing the olives to get the oil out. It's a long, tedious, painful process, but we must go through it. But in the end, we will have the olive oil to give to others. Now, basically what I want to point out here is that Balak, who was this king of Moab, he saw what Israel had done to the Amorites. Now we have Moab and the Ammon, the Amorites. Moab and Ammon basically were the sons of Lot with his daughters after they fled Sodom. So that basically is a spiritual, they're basically the product of spiritual fornication. It's actually quite horrible if you think about it, but spiritually it means they are like those that do not have a pure form of religion, that are and that want basically to join things together that ought not be together. So Balak basically saw that Israel had overcome the Amorites, so he feared because they were many. What that generally would mean is when Christianity becomes strong, when true Christianity, true believers who hold fast to the word of God in the way that it leads to prosperity, and leads to righteousness in a country and justice, when that becomes many, then the evildoers can't flourish, you see? Then they have to work for a living. They can't be bribing and all sorts of shenanigans among the politicians, and the gangsters can't flourish, and the mafia can't flourish, and the human trafficking and all the sins by which they live and make their money. So that is what this means spiritually, you see. So when a country is doing the right thing, when many of the citizens are righteous, it leads to justice in that country. And so, yeah, you basically have a king who has a problem in that sense. So what did he do? He got a hireling. He needs a hireling. And he says to them, behold, there's a people come out of Egypt. Behold, they cover the face of the earth and they abide over against me. Now, if you think in the following way, don't think now of the nation of Israel coming out of Egypt. That is the initial meaning. But now if you think spiritually, so that you can be of help to Christianity, then what you need to do is think of Jesus Christ as being the second Exodus. So coming out of Egypt is us following Christ out of Babylon, or out of spiritual Egypt, the bondage that they were under by that corrupt system which had come to oppress them. So as Christians, we came out of spiritual Egypt with Christ being like the second Moses, a second Exodus. The statue in Daniel said that the stone would basically be a kingdom to cover the whole earth. So it says they're covering the face of the earth. So Christianity is spreading out and is standing against those that wish to live in another way, that don't want justice, that want lawlessness. They basically want to create conditions so that Christianity will be reversed, so that it will be destroyed. And so they brought the rewards of divination to Balaam the hireling. The reason it's the rewards of divination is because he is going to prophesy certain things. And in the New Testament, we read it was called the rewards of unrighteousness. So for money, he would prophesy things that would cause harm. Now, he is a prophet, and he actually, he speaks to God. Now, I don't believe that's literal. I believe that's just like us saying, I'm going to ask the Lord, I'm going to go to God in my prayer closet. So that's how he went to him. People tend to think these things are all literal, and then you get so deceived, people. You get so deceived. You have to start thinking spiritually and stop seeing things like a little child. Those days are behind us. So he sought God, and God told them, you shall not go with them, nor shall you curse the people, for they are blessed. So when he sought the Lord, God was against that. And so Balaam went and said to Balak, no, I can't do this. This is not something the Lord wants me to do. But of course, Balak just kept on sending more messengers and promising to promote him to great honor. This would be akin to pastors being risen to great honor, especially those that preach false doctrine. They get great honor. They get promoted in this world to positions of great honor. And then Balaam said, I cannot go beyond the word of the Lord my God to do less or more. Now, it's quite shocking that he calls the Lord his God, yet it is in his heart to actually get this money. He says God came to Balaam at night and said to him, if the men come to call to you, rise up, go with them, but the word that I shall say to you, that shall you do. So Balaam persisted, and now God is giving him permission to go with them. And when he does, God is angry at him. What I think it means is when you read in the Bible and you know something is wrong, but you want to do it, and so you go and find other passages in the Bible to sort of give you permission to do it. And so this thing where God says, go with them, this is actually in the heart of Balaam, where he is starting to rest with God and wrestle with scripture in order to still do the right thing in his eyes, but not get on the wrong side of the Lord. That's why God gets angry. People read this and then they think God is the problem, but it's Balaam that is the problem. Now, yeah, in Ezekiel 14, you get the answer to what is happening here with Balaam. Why is he going against the Lord, yet it seems that the Lord is telling him to actually now go with them, and then the Lord is going to give him words to speak, which ultimately leads to destruction. This doesn't make sense to us, but let's read there and try and understand. It says there in Ezekiel 14, verse 1, I'm going to read there down. It says, then came certain of the elders of Israel to me, and they sat before me. And the word of the Lord came to me, saying, son of man, these men have set up their idols in their heart and put the stumbling block of their iniquity before their face. Should I be inquired of at all by them? Therefore, speak to them and say to them, thus says the Lord God, every man of the house of Israel that sets up his idols in his heart and puts the stumbling block of his iniquity before his face and comes to the prophet, I, the Lord, will answer him that comes according to the multitude of his idols, that I may take the house of Israel in their own heart, because they are all estranged from me through their idols. Okay, so what the Lord's saying, yeah, is if you go to the Lord, but you have an idol in your heart, and that you are going to cause stumbling blocks, which is exactly what Balaam did, causing stumbling blocks of iniquity, then the Lord says, why should I be inquired? So Balaam came to the Lord. The Lord told him, no, don't go. You can't curse them. He told them. But now Balaam keeps going. And now the Lord is basically saying, why should I be inquired of Balaam? Because he's got this idol in him. He's covetousness. He's covetous. And covetousness, we read in the Old New Testament, is part of the works of the flesh, which is idolatry. Why should God now answer him? He says. And then he says this very shocking thing. He says, I, the Lord, will answer him that comes to me according to the multitude of his idols. Now, people, this is really scary. Think about it. If you go to the Lord and you read in your Bible and you want answers, and you have idols in your heart, then you are going to read, in other words, be answered according to your idols. Now, that is exactly why we have Christian Zionism. Why are evangelical Christians and many, many others actually reading the terrible things they read and saying the terrible things they say by, for example, going along with this doctrine that idolizes the state of Israel because they have this idol in their heart? Israel has become an idol in the hearts of people, and therefore the scriptures and the Lord through the scriptures is answering them according to this idol. So this is what is going to happen to Balaam. He is going to be a prophet with false doctrine in his mouth. So if you even go to a prophet, he said, he will answer him through the prophet according to the multitude of his idols. And that's exactly what happens. People even look to Balaam as prophesying the Messiah, whereas we read that Balaam is a false prophet. And then people take this star prophecy and this prophecy of this violent Messiah that came out of the mouth of Balaam as being a prophecy of Jesus Christ's second coming. That is crazy. Balaam was prophesying the actions of the Antichrist. And that is how this works, by him actually prophesying truthful things, things that will happen. But then people take that as being good when it is prophesying the natural result of what is going to happen when there is disobedience, or it is basically answering them according to their idols. And the Lord says he wants to take them, in other words, ensnare them because of the idolatry. And the Lord is righteous in this. Why should he be inquired by somebody who wants to take the scriptures in order to curse his people? Why should he be answered? Why should he not answer them according to their idols? I see that this is right, but we as people cannot do this. Only God can do this. Because when we do this, when we twist the scriptures in order to set traps for others, that is very, very evil. But when God does it, he does it in a way which is righteous, because he will protect his people and he will punish those evildoers through this. And yeah, he goes on in verse 7, for everyone in the house of Israel or of the stranger that sojourns in Israel, which separates himself from me and sets up his idol in his heart. How do we separate ourselves from him? We become cut off from Christ, which is his word. And then we have an idol in our heart, yet we continue to read the Bible, and put the stumbling block of his iniquity before his face, and comes to a prophet to inquire of him concerning me, I, the Lord, will answer him by myself, and I will set my face against that man and make him a sign and a proverb, and I will cut him off from the midst of my people, and you shall know that I am the Lord. This is because destruction will come, and we will see that this has come upon us because of our own idols. And if the prophet be deceived when he has spoken the thing, I, the Lord, have deceived that prophet, and I will stretch out my hand upon him and will destroy him in the midst of my people Israel, and they shall bear the punishment of their iniquity. The punishment of the prophet shall be even as the punishment of him that seeks unto him. So if we go to false prophets like Haggai, we will receive that same punishment that is coming to the deceiving prophet also. And that prophet may perfectly speak what is written, but is deceiving and is a hireling. So the problem is those who are, for example, in Judaism, they read this, or not just in Judaism, any carnal person reading this, when they are wicked, they will say, well, God does this. He deceives the prophet, so I can also deceive others if it's for a good cause, not understanding what God is spiritually saying here. Namely, it is him answering through the word, but because of our idols, we basically believe the deception which our carnal mind gives us by refusing to believe the truth. And then by taking scriptures out of context, or putting scriptures together that shouldn't be together, and being deceived, or by following a false prophet that leads into perdition. Now we see, as I say, that God is angry because Balaam is coming to him with an idol in his heart and is planning to throw a stumbling block in front of the children of Israel. So then it says, the angel of the Lord stood in the way for an adversary against him. So basically, Balaam has now made himself an enemy of God. You see. Now it speaks of how cruel Balaam becomes to the ass upon which he rides. Now, what we need to think of is basically does the ass represent? If Balaam basically represents your typical false prophet, upon whose back does he go? Who is the ass? Think of Christ who was the good prophet and rode on the ass into Jerusalem. So basically, what is the ass? It is the Christians, you see. It represents the people that are being ridden by this false prophet. We can think of the scriptures that says the woman rides the beast. So the woman representing a false church or a false prophet riding a beast, which is what the people become when they listen to lies. Okay, so this ass is a beast. So it's being ridden by a false prophet. And now we see how cruel the false prophet becomes by hitting this animal, when this animal actually is the one that sees the truth, that sees the danger. So as the people, a lot of Christians warn and want to stop this progress of listening to false doctrine, for example, the Zionist doctrine, the more the people speak against it, the more the false prophet actually becomes cruel and smites. So yeah, in Matthew 24, right towards the end, we read the following. We read the difference between the faithful and wise servant and the evil servant. And it says, who then is a faithful and wise servant, whom his Lord has made a ruler over the household to give them meat in due season? Blessed is that servant whom his Lord, when he comes, shall find so doing. Verily I say to you that he shall make him ruler over all his goods. But if that evil servant say in his heart, my Lord delay in his coming, and shall begin to smite his fellow servants and to eat and drink with a drunken, the Lord of that servant shall come in a day when he looked not for him, and in an hour that he is not aware of, and he shall cut him asunder and appoint him his portion with the hypocrites, there shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. So yeah, you see this eating of the fellow servants. In other words, the false teachers, the false prophets, they basically start to be cruel towards the other believers. And that's exactly what we see here with Balaam. And now here we see that the Lord says to Balaam, go with the men, but only speak the words that I say. So you see, that's exactly what Ezekiel 14 said. I, the Lord God, will answer him according to the idols in his heart. And those that inquire of him will also receive the same judgment and punishment. In other words, Balak and Balaam are going to, by this evil thing that they did, they are both going to basically receive the just reward for their wickedness. And the Lord is going to give them the exact words. I don't have any power to say anything except the word that God has put in my mouth, that shall I speak. So understand, these words come from the Lord. He is going to answer Balaam, the false prophet, according to the idols of his heart. I find it shocking and horrifying that people do not take this to heart, that this Bible is dangerous if you don't know what you're doing, and if you are going with a, if you are worshiping the Lord in vain, you are using religion and you are using the scriptures to, and if I say you, I mean a person. I don't mean you personally. I should say a person. In my native language, when you say you do this, you do that, it doesn't mean you personally to whom I'm speaking. I basically means a person. So I should try and remember, because in the English language, it can sometimes sound like I'm accusing you. But I know that somebody who actually takes the time to listen to me, you know, you're the choir. You are not guilty, probably, I hope, of this. You are trying to understand. So please forgive me if I sound like I'm accusing you. I'm certainly not. All I'm saying is, you know, like the Bible says, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. We can love the Heavenly Father if we come to Him with a pure heart and a heart that's full of truth. Then this doesn't even, we don't even need to be worried. Because even if we have certain erroneous beliefs, He will look at our heart. If our heart is straight and pure before Him, even in our deceptions, He will help us and teach us and correct us. But when people come with these evil things whereby they use the scriptures to deceive and destroy, then God comes to them as an enemy. It says, if you love the things of the world, you make yourself an enemy of God. And God Himself says, He will come to you as a lion and as a bear, as a beast, basically. Everybody is so worried about the beast in Revelation. Now we become those beasts, and the earthly kingdoms become that. But we must also remember that basically what happens is God then basically gives us over to this evil that's in us. And we become this carnal beast as people and as a society. So we become our own enemy because of our own wickedness. So now as we go on, we keep saying that, seeing that basically Balaam keeps trying to divine against Israel, but he cannot. He has to speak the words given to him, meaning he must basically use the scriptures. He has to use the truth, and he wants to use it in such a way that he can get the reward for doing what Balak wants him to do. And then it's when he speaks all these prophecies, like the one about the people rising up as the lion and eating the prey. So it goes on, they keep trying and make, so he makes all his oracles, which are basically all about the fact that Israel is blessed and will destroy the enemy. He prophesies that the kingdom shall be exalted. This specific prophecy, he shall pour out the water of his buckets, and his seed shall be in many waters, and his king shall be higher than Agag, and his kingdom shall be exalted. My understanding of this is this prophesies Jesus Christ and Christianity. That's why it's got this water, that the water, the living water, the seed be in many waters, meaning that it's basically the believers, first the Israelites were dispersed everywhere, and they became the Christians, and they went everywhere through the British Empire. It went all over the earth, and the kingdom of Christ was exalted. And then he goes on to say, God brought him forth out of Egypt. Now I have explained that, what that means spiritually, meaning that through Christianity, they came out of the spiritual Egypt, which was the bondage that they'd created using the law. So the law is good, but they created a system under which the people were in bondage under the Pharisees. Then it speaks of the strength of the unicorn, which I've already spoken about. And he shall eat up the nations, his enemies, and he shall break their bones. So now this Messiah, yeah, which basically is a teacher giving the living waters, now suddenly destroys these nations, you see, and pierce them through with his arrows. Now the arrows point to deception, because Satan has fiery arrows. So why are we going here from what seems to be Jesus Christ to what seems to be Satan, you see? And it's because of this that there are these people that say that where you have those doctrines in Freemasonry, which basically says that, you know, Jesus is the bad one. It reverses it. So what they say is Jesus Christ is actually evil and is deceiving the people. And of course, from the viewpoint of somebody in Judaism, they would think that, because of the fact that he basically ended the law of Moses, and they believe themselves they must be under the law of Moses. They have not had the revelation of the freedom we get in Christ, and that righteousness isn't by works of the law. Now, by this, I'm not saying that every Jewish person is evil or deceived. I don't think they all try and use the law to be righteous. I think there are of them that really are seeking the truth, that seek the scriptures. The thing is, they don't come to Christ, so they keep relying on their own works, and then they cannot see him, you see. Okay, so yeah, you've got this, to me, this Messiah, which to me is the Antichrist. And that's what I'm starting to see, is basically that Balaam, what he did was he mixed the two. He mixed the Messiah, Jesus Christ, with the Antichrist. So he basically says, okay, yeah, he is in the time of Christianity blessing everywhere, but then in the end, he's going to destroy and eat up these nations. Now, there is a spiritual truth in that, in the sense that Christianity does actually devour the ways of the nations. It devours the pagan ways of the nations and makes them Christian. But how the enemies of Christianity sees this and how it's specifically seen in Judaism and in Zionism is actually to physically destroy everybody. You see, so it becomes very evil when seen carnally. And I personally think this is speaking of the Antichrist. So Balaam is mixing his prophesying of Jesus Christ and his prophesying of the Antichrist. And then people think this is all the work of Jesus Christ, that he will basically crush the enemies. And that's where this doctrine comes from, which is rampant. You see that it's the few that say, well, you know, Christ came and he set up the kingdom of God, and slowly through spreading the gospel, the world is becoming better, and the knowledge of God is covering the earth, and Christ will, eventually his kingdom will totally cover the earth. In other words, it will be a peaceful, loving way through justice and mercy. But now people have turned from that, or maybe from the beginning they've believed this lie. You know, I mean, Balaam preached it, namely that basically this Messiah will do this through violence. And if you think of Christianity, it did have its violent takeovers of many colonies. So you had your missionaries there, they were doing it in the way that Jesus Christ taught us, but you also had the colonists who basically used the Bible and did it through violence. You get both of these, you see. So this is why I'm saying this doctrine is so important. And in the case of Jewish Zionism, they believe that they need to destroy Christianity. They see Christianity as the evil twin brother Esau that sold their birthright. So this is where this doctrine comes from, that Zionism of this ferocious Jesus. Now, in the book of Revelation, it sort of can give you that idea if you see Christ as that he's going to physically destroy and force this rule upon everybody. Whereas there are many scriptures that Jesus goes against that. All his actions and everything spoke of not taking the kingdom by violence. As the scripture said in the Old Testament, not by might nor by power, but by my spirit. So he keeps saying that he cannot do anything beyond what God allows him or tells him to speak. And then he says he will advertise what will happen to the people in the latter days. So he's prophesying of basically end times. And I've warned against this, and Jesus warned against this. He said they'll come and say they're the Messiah and it's the end times. Or the Messiah is coming and it's the end times. And that's exactly what I see. People's lives have been so destroyed, especially since the 1800s, with all this that we're living in the end times. How many people's lives have been destroyed? How many women have lived in fear and not had the joy of the Lord in their hearts because of all this end times teaching? And it goes on and on and on. And it is very, very easy for the enemy, especially in our day, to use the media to create the prophecies, to force them, to fulfill them for themselves, or even just to deceive. Now, one could probably argue that if they fulfill the prophecies themselves, it is a fulfillment of prophecy. But if the Christians didn't believe it, if the Christians didn't believe in this violent Jesus, or if they didn't believe that we are going to be under the Messiah, son of David, the Davidic Messiah that the Jews wait for, if they believed that the kingdom of Christ would be peaceful and loving, then they wouldn't believe the lies that the Jews tell us and the Zionists tell us. And then these things wouldn't work because they wouldn't go and fight their wars for them in the Middle East. I mean, the Jews are very small. They cannot fight their own wars. They need the masses of the Christians to do it for them. And they also use Islam. They pit them against each other because one must remember that, like, Zionists are in position of power in the West, they are also in the East in positions of power. So it's easy for them to control things using the Bible, using the faith of the Christians and of Islam, which is also an Abrahamic religion. Paul prophesied that false signs and wonders would be used. Jesus said that. You see? Okay, so here is the star prophecy, which I also spoke about when I went through my table to show how the doctrine of Balaam is exactly the doctrine of Zionism. It says, I see him, but not now. I shall behold him, but not now. There come a star out of Jacob, and a scepter shall arise out of Israel, and shall smite the corners of Moab, and destroy all the children of Seth. So now he's actually prophesying to Moab of their destruction. Also, it's very strange that this Messiah would destroy if this was Jesus. Now, I see in the scepter out of Israel, I do see Christ, but why is he destroying the children of Seth? You know, that is very, very strange. The star out of Jacob to me is the Antichrist. So what I see is he's basically making them one. And that's exactly what people are doing. They are changing the nature of how they see Christ into being like the Antichrist, which is exactly the Messiah that the Jews are waiting for, a violent Messiah that will basically force Judaism upon the world. And it's interesting that he now prophesies to, in front of the king of Moab, the destruction of Moab. Very, very interesting, because in Christianity, we are constantly hearing now that the West is going to be destroyed and the fall of America and the West. We are constantly hearing how we are going to be destroyed. Very interesting this, that, you know, that this came to Moab. Especially if you see what happens later on now, in the next chapter, where, you know, the daughters of Moab now start to mingle with the Israelites. Okay, and he says then, basically, Jacob shall have the dominion and destroy him that remains of the city, the remnant. In other words, he's going to destroy his enemies. He's going to destroy even the remnant of his enemies. Now, people, this really doesn't sound like Jesus Christ. This sounds like the Antichrist. Jesus Christ destroys his enemies in the sense that they no longer are his enemies. They are won over to the side of truth, and in that way, they are destroyed. But not in this violent way. We see in Numbers 25, immediately after this, these oracles, this divination, this prophecy of Balaam, we see that Israel now begins to commit whoredom with Moab. So you get immediately this fornication, and then the people eat and bow to their gods. And Israel joined themselves to basically worship the same as the Moabites. And then you get this plague. If we compare this to Revelation, we see the parallel. And unto the church in Thyatira write these things, says the Son of God. And then he says, I have a few things against you because you suffer that woman Jezebel, which calls herself a prophetess, the false prophet, to seduce my servants to commit fornication and eat things sacrificed to idols, which is exactly the same that happened with Israel and Moab. They started to commit fornication with the daughters of Moab and started to sacrifice and eat things sacrificed to idols. I will cast her into a bed. I will kill her children with death. What happened? They got the plague. They were cast into a sick bed. You see, it's exactly the same pattern. So yeah, you've got this false prophet. And what happens after the preaching of the false prophet? The people have this problem of this plague, which I think is basically the spiritual contamination of false doctrine, which leads to spiritual death and finally physical death as these things manifest on earth. And we connected it also previously to the doctrine of Balaam, which we said is the doctrine to eat things sacrificed to idols and commit fornication. Or it's not the doctrine, the result of it, shall I say. The result of Balaam, who taught Balak to cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel, to eat things sacrificed to idol and to commit fornication. Remember, we read in Ezekiel 14 of the stumbling block that comes when the false prophet inquires of the Lord with an idol in his heart, or somebody inquires with an idol in his heart of a false prophet. Then we read about this stumbling block. And the stumbling block is, I think, the false Messiah, because Jesus was called the stumbling block. The stumbling block he was called. He was the true Messiah. But what I see is that this stumbling block is that they basically have us follow the false Messiah, the anti-Messiah, the violent Messiah of Zionism. He is the stumbling block to us, and it leads us to basically spiritually eat with the Zionists and to fornicate with them. In other words, to Judaize the church is spiritual fornication. To basically believe the doctrines of Zionism is eating with the Judaizers spiritually. And believing this doctrine of Balaam, of seeing Christ as this violent Messiah, as seeing our Messiah as the same Messiah they have. Like John Hagee said, your Messiah is our Messiah and our Messiah is your Messiah. So basically what they're saying is Jesus Christ is basically the Antichrist, which is the exact doctrine of the Freemasons and the Illuminati, that they're one and the same. And the result of this is spiritual death. So we saw the same pattern in the West. We saw that in the 60s when there was the so-called sexual revolution, you started to seeing this fornication. And the moment that started, then the people started to bow down before other gods. So it was first this fornication with the sexual revolution, and then the people started using drugs and all sorts of strange teachings and false religions came, especially in America, and it started being acceptable. And things just went worse, from bad to worse. So you basically have this joining of the people of God with the world, which is what Moab is. Moab is one foot in, one foot out, the mixing of truth and error, being a lukewarm believer, and everything goes. And then you have this spiritual sickness which results in death. But it eventually manifests, people. You know, we had this thing that happened in our world this so-called plague, of which the cure of the plague is killing many people, the cure of the plague. So the false doctrine of the false prophet leads to destruction. So why did God allow this? Why did he allow this false prophet to prophesy these things that eventually also led to destruction in his own camp? It is because I think they tolerated this false prophet. They believed him. They believed the lie. Revelation 2:20, because you suffer that woman Jezebel, who calls herself a prophetess, to teach and seduce my servants to commit fornication and eat things sacrificed to idols. Israel suffered Balaam. They allowed him. To suffer means to permit. To permit. So in the church today, people permit this false teaching. They permit Christian Zionism. Now, please don't feel personally responsible, because there is such an overwhelming majority of people who believe this. So if you did believe this, or if you are one of those that don't believe it and you are shocked at what you're seeing, I'm not trying to make you feel worse. You've had enough guilt placed upon you, which you are not guilty of. But by showing yourself this, by understanding this, you are actually helping, even though it may not feel that way. Okay? So we've all believed lies. Don't feel condemned by what I'm saying, but it doesn't change the fact that the church is allowing our own destruction. And that's why I think the Lord also basically allowed this to come upon Israel. He basically destroyed Moab through it, because they then bound themselves to Israel, because when they heard that Israel was going to destroy them, they, of course, believed the lie. And so they started to do exactly what the Christian church does with the Jews, is to join up with them and to form an alliance with them. And it basically caused destruction on both sides. So this is what's happening also in Christianity and Judaism. Both sides are having a lot of destruction because of this mixing that is going on. In Deuteronomy 13, we read the following. If there arise among you a prophet or a dreamer of dreams, and he gives you a sign and a wonder, and the sign and the wonder comes to pass, whereof he spake to you, saying, let us go after other gods which you have not known, and let us serve them, you shall not hearken to the words of that prophet or that dreamer of dreams, for the Lord your God proves you to know whether you love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul. You shall walk after the Lord your God and fear him and keep his commandments and obey his voice, and you shall serve him and cleave to him. And that prophet or dreamer of dreams shall be put to death, because he has spoken to turn you away from the Lord your God, which brought you out of the land of Egypt and redeemed you out of the house of bondage, to thrust you out of the way which the Lord has commanded you to walk in. If we apply this to Christianity, what it is basically saying is, it doesn't matter if they're bringing signs and wonders of the end times, if you're seeing the red heifer and you're seeing all these wars in Israel, they are signs and wonders, and they could be signs and lying wonders come to pass. Remember, Paul said that the coming of the lawless one is with all sorts of lying signs and wonders that are designed to deceive people. Yet people are looking at the news, and then they are all proclaiming it is the end times and bringing it upon themselves, because the enemy is bringing signs and lying wonders. Okay, so even if a prophet is able to correctly predict the future, if their prophecies come true, but they tell you to worship another god, you should not listen to them. So what are all these Zionist prophets and pastors teaching you. They are teaching you to submit yourself to Israel, to the physical people, and have the physical people rule over the Christians. So no longer do you bow to Christ, but you bow to Israel, to the people, to the Jews. You see, and this is a test. It is a test. Jesus Christ took us out of spiritual bondage in Egypt, not for us to go right back under it. That is going back, like it says in 1 Kings 13, do not go back by the way you came. We're not to go back and fall back into law keeping. So Balaam spoke these signs and wonders, and this is what people follow today. And God has answered Balaam according to the idols of his heart to cast a stumbling stone before the Christians so that they will believe the false signs and lying wonders. They believe the lie. And by believing the lie, we get destroyed. We get destroyed because we are following the false prophet who is a Judas goat who leads us into perdition. And that is why the world is in the state it is now. So don't be discouraged. We only need the eyes to be healed. The eyes of the body must see the truth. When the eyes see, then the rest of the body will see. So if you're part of an eye, if you can see these things, we need to be connected again to each other and not be divided by being fearful of being deceived by each other, but trusting the Lord, listening to his voice alone as he reveals the truth to you. It is a slow process, but we need to go through this to see the truth again. We cannot make the Messiah that the Jews see, this Messiah, to be Jesus. The thing Balaam prophesied is the thing that comes upon us if we believe lies. So what God was basically showing him, what he saw, is that that is the destruction that he saw from believing the lie. We don't have to believe the lie. If we don't believe the lie, and if we believe in the Lamb, then we will have peace. Yes, the world won't be perfect, but we will not have this crazy world, and we will have righteousness in it, because Jesus Christ is the perfect balance of mercy and righteousness. But when we follow the ways of the world, the secular world, they are all about only mercy. They want nothing to do with justice. So they're skewed to mercy. Or if we follow the Zionist Jews or any form of Judaism, Judaism also actually leans towards mercy. They're very lax, in fact, on judgment. But they can get out of whack and be all about judgment of the nations, not themselves. They scapegoat the nations. They don't look at themselves like we do in Christianity and try and see the beam in our eye. They don't do that. You see, they only look outwardly. Now, I mustn't generalize. There could be of them that do that. But I found them mostly to be very lenient and merciful towards those that actually need correction. And so the world is out of whack, and Christianity, as it ought to be, is the balancer. It's the one that can do, you know, if you think of the cross, Jesus was in the middle with the two thieves to the side. So he's the balance. In him, mercy and righteousness are balanced, even though it says mercy does triumph. So that's the grace that we have. But when it gets out of whack, then we get a world that either goes into overdrive judgment, which is where you get these revolutions that become physical and people lose their lives. And they have the reaction to being, you know, too lax, too merciful. You can be too merciful where it's not real mercy. It's basically just there's no righteousness. And then there's mercy for those that should be receiving judgment. For example, criminals, they're constantly receiving mercy. And that is not balanced. So the moment you combine Christianity with Judaism, you get a terribly toxic mix, which leads to spiritual death and extreme destruction, not only for Christians, also for Jews. And we need to get back into balance.